coaching their teams. So what we've asked them to do is to go around one by one. Coach's going to give us one opportunity to express what she has. We come to heal with another one. We'll even skip our coaches here and come over. And we'll go around the group. And they'll probably come up with 17 things, if not 27 things, that they may have to do as a coach individually with their teams to get them out before you even see them, before they walk on the court. Coach Lewis decided to join us.
Sorry.
We thank her for being here with us today, doing a great program with the ladies and girls of the Strawberry Press. We're trying to keep with our Title IX obligations. It's very well. She doesn't have a few children today, so I'm not really technical, but she likes to say it. Yeah, well, always looking good. So
thank you.
Coach, if you have a question, at least I'll start. And just expand on what we mentioned. Please explain to our officials your game debuts along the way. Again, we're going to go around the room in rapid succession, each coach stating one duty at a time. Please expound upon any unique or difficult responsibilities. Somebody else may have already mentioned. So you got a kid that may live in Riverview, but yet you're coaching West Ham. And I gotta get that guy back and forth. That's the unique difficulty that you have amongst your team. So Todd, you wanna go first? Game debut on the ball well.
I think one of the biggest game debuts we had is just getting everything ready for game setup. We kind of get, I know at our school, we do it all ourselves. We get the chairs laid out, bleachers down, we pick up the gym, make sure it looks good, clean the backboards if they're dirty, put the nets up, all those things that I know the rest of us has now a project. There's, you know, every game day, take a lot of pride, making sure it looks good, floor's done well, but that's on us.
Yeah, setting up the gym, that's a big deal. Also, team meals, trying to coordinate that. We try to feed the kids the best we can. Get the uniforms ready, gotta wash all the uniforms, bring them in, give them to the kids, all that.
Keep here so you all have so I can have my personal space.
year. The boys are the ones available for a lot of their office available, so y'all can go in and shower with us women. So that's a big problem that I have in my school. I'm about to give you all a place where y'all can have with other ladies or other teams so we should use the boys and girls soccer.
Jump in here. One thing that none of them mentioned, they're talking about their own game, but when they're the visitor, there's this whole deal of getting to the game, transportation. And sometimes, most times, transportation is outside of their control. Just so you all are aware of our process in the school district, the earliest buses are guaranteed to a school is 5:15. Well, if you think about different parts of our county, trying to leave at 5:15 and get to a school in the opposite end to start at 6:30, that's a virtual impossibility. So I want to mention that because we need you all to be flexible with us, because we have a team that is all the stuff that they mentioned that's going through their mind, their process, they're still having to deal with getting actually to the facility, and then sometimes there's this rush for them to get on the court. Well, we want it to be a contest that is the best quality, so sometimes we have to slow down, let all of that happen, and then get them on the court. Now, we don't want it to be unreasonable, but we do want it to be reasonable. And so I wanted to make sure to throw out that transportation piece, because the visiting team is not them being purposely late, right? And when they get to the school and everyone's rushing them, can you imagine what that does to that team? So I think that would definitely
be worth it. Well, I'll be able to bring to man the sales server for you as part of one more industry.
Well, you know, and Todd brings it up. Way out of the schools, oftentimes, those aren't our issues. Because when we know we're going to our great professional people feel, or they're coming to us, there's more of a charter bus that gets them to play. But when we're talking about from Alonzo to Durant, that's going to be a school bus. Right? You ever remember from Alonzo to Durant? They would need to leave at like 5:15 a.m.
Somebody, you're going to talk. Okay, so it's all going to bounce out.
talk about the topic.
You need to open up communication. What do we expect him to get his kids to hustle into the locker room and not just be dragging them up by his? But we'll come to him and say, you know, those are the time to meet. We're going to have a lot of time on that clock. And we're going to go with that. I remember, and I'm old, okay? So, I was 14 years old, working at a basketball camp in the summertime, and I needed to be rehabilitated. And I went out to say, where did you go? Like, in the back. There, Dr. J, tennis. How many of you guys know those all stars? That little girl with the side of the star shoe? That was my first pair. Of course, I had to go to the side of town to get a pair of size 13s back then. Okay? Because back then, 13s were like common. And I had to go to the side of town, best choice, get these tennis shoes. You know, not the best part of town, because when I was lucky to get my tennis shoes back home that day.
Nothing's going to change the way you're going to do it. So I had that whole shooting about 10 years. The man said,
Hillsborough County school, it is our policy. So that means regular season, postseason,
that's not this, right? That's not having it cut down to be that. That's not a mouthpiece. A mouthpiece protects the teeth and the mouth as a whole. So that's the very first one that always gets a lot of discussion. And then our second one that gets lots more discussion is our profanity. We don't tolerate it. Don't tolerate it from these folks. Won't tolerate it from the young people playing the games. Let me tell you the reason why. It's very simple. If you address the small problems such as profanity, you never have a big, or you're less likely to have a big problem. So we've instituted that. I've been in this job. As people say, how's the new job? The new job is now 8 years old, right? So I've been in the job for 8 years, and I started that process of let's eject our profanity. I said it, I reiterated. I didn't start it. That was our work before I got in this job, but I don't know that it reiterated to the same level that I have. I do it because I don't want to have bigger issues. Let me say that again. I don't want to have bigger issues. I believe by addressing smaller issues quickly, swiftly, promptly, and consistently, you won't develop the bigger issues. Guess what? The data says supports that. We have less injections. You know what? We have less injections across all sports as a result of what I think is a very small change, addressing problems quickly and early so that it doesn't escalate. Now, for these coaches sitting here, I'll say it. When the coach or the kid curses during the game, I want you to inject it. That's not the first time that happened. So it's really going to be their job to stop it in practice long before it gets to you. Because if it gets to that point, then there needs to be a problem. So having said that, those are the two things that are most unique to us. And I say that the ejection rule is unique to us because there is the possibility for, and I would be remiss if I didn't say it as a basketball coach, there's a possibility for a T unsportsmanlike and all these different types of things. I don't know. Eject them. Immediately. Because guess what? Next time they'll think about it. Does that make sense to everyone? And I'll be glad to see your questions on any of those two. Even if it's only those two.
Because you're in line, but it actually is a little different. So,
when you write up an injection, I want you to write, and the FHSA wants you to write exactly what was said. Because they actually go for every curse word, they go to cheat, they cash register room. It generally has up to be about $100 a word. Right? Now these coaches, I don't know who exactly, but I believe there's something from somewhere around $2,500. Right? So if they get a good long one in there.
But the film said one thing, and the official said something else. And I may have just offended someone else.
But if the eye of the sky doesn't lie, y'all heard that one before, right? That's all. That's it.
So we did go on two things there. And one of them is important to us officials that we asked you to get to your games early. So that does take all that road clear, all that work clear, all that model and proper clear that you can have at home. And you can be good about it.
Live play, ball play, they are as favorite time. They're on the watch time. Air ball, recovery time, those type of things. That's just a common sense to it.
Coaches aren't going to tell me that. They're smart not to respond right now. That's not happening. But that is the expectation of the school district.
Right. We're in practice. It's easy to
if that is that case.
No, that's not following the mountain rule. This is a very simple thing. The ball is in play, the mountain should be in. If it's not in, they're violation of our requirement. Very, very simple. So I think we're all saying the same thing.
Last one of the mountain is in the mountain.
All right, let me go ahead. If
it falls out accidentally, then they can try to get back in their mouth. Right? Now that's nasty. But it's required. Say again. Let's not overthink it.
That's not good. That's not a waste of time, guys. Come on now. We go through this because we have to have a rule. But let's not get into these one-off individual situations. We can always find an exception to every rule. That's not what this forum or any type of teaching concept is about, guys. All right? Let's understand live ball, mouthpiece needs to be in. Dead ball situation, they got a recovery situation, it is what it is, all right?
Issues with me being on the state court, we get those a lot. Now, the process is, and coaches, this is for you too as well. Please do not get into a game situation where coaches will say, hey, that kid fought last night. There's no way he should have been in this game. And we get it. We get those a lot. I get emails from coaches and from parents saying there's no way that kid should be allowed to play that game. Officials, please stay out of it. Okay? It's a process in it. We must submit those disciplinary forms to the state. Today, or your president, they will submit the state. That takes 24 to 48 hours. Guys, don't email Lance about that. We get that stuff. Do not get into it with the coaches. If you know it's an all-out brawl, you just do it. If it's an all-out brawl, Berkeley's friend, top of breath, and you're like, there's no way that kid should play, stay out of it. Because we have a process. So coaches, be aware of that. I know it may happen. You may see that player fight, and that be a star player, and you say there's no way they can play, let the state know. Please.
We will address that from this.
It's a standard deal. If the student gets ejected, they sit. They sit for a minimum of a week unless they hear otherwise. So that's clearly stated. So we shouldn't have their opinions on, but it does happen.
This will be clear for me. Ejected for some time for the games you heard.
Coaching, just be consistent. I know this is how you're going to work the game. I instruct my players. prepared. You know, just the way we play, so I'll be ready to play. But if I can't get a B on it, if I can't get a B on it, that's what it causes problems, especially if it's what's happening. One curse will not go, curse, and next night, the next week coming in, they try to force that on you, so a lot of issues.
Thank you.
Yes, I do. I know it was on the long time. I did already make sure it was that. I do for sure. Because like I said, and all the questions, it's important to find those on the floor. I can't read my rules when I'm off the floor, so I do know the rules from them. And when they do break the rule, like I said, I give them so hard, like I'm free to go all the time, I'm not going in. And then after that, I do discipline my girls. Any rules they break, that is disrespectful or damn, association rules or even my rules. So I do the court's rules.
I go to the rules of my parents for a long time. Every year, it's not the coach. Always have referees come in, was that over the new rules that year, points of emphasis, but that was not new rules, points of emphasis. That particular season, I continuously go over with the guys, during practice, games, we try to, so they get used to handshake or not holding it or different stuff. I don't want to practice, you want to whistle every 2 seconds, but you try to pull the rules and get used to playing a certain way. I coach my players to get present as well, but half you need the rule. So you got to keep your hands off, you got to move feet, so you got to go over the rules. There's something that happens in the game with one of my players, like they say, ask the coach why is this called, or why is this called. A lot of times we'll film the rule that my boys are busy called. A lot of times, they tell me, coach, I didn't thought it's first, I didn't do it. She said, before the guy is not missing that line, so I showed him. When he was out, this is why his line was wrong. That's what he was doing.
Yeah, I've seen what this coach was doing. Going to the cursing rule, especially Bill from County. Try to emphasize it to the team and practice and happens. Try to get on the line correctly because I don't see any good going on with him.
We definitely talked about it. That gave an example of some kids playing last high school game, and the last thing I remember on the court is being ejected because they got sent 6 weeks. It's a shame. That's the last thing I remember about a game. In terms of hand checks, why did that make the most difficult for us as coaches and maybe I'm sure you guys as officials to understand the overall consistency of being the game on that particular rule? Can you maybe give us, it's one item, maybe it's 2 hands on back, and the next time we're going to talk to them, it's 1 hand, you know, it's second, you do it the next time, it's not, and I think that is, and I understand it's difficult, but I think for me as a coach, that is the most difficult one to.
No, you're right.
And I think on the flip side of that is, going in from a coach's perspective, I need to talk to fellow coaches, you're better off. Let's go see how it's called that night. Let's get out there and see two hands on it. And if that's not called right away, you're being an advantage. Let's, you know, if it's like that is not called right away, it's something you control it as the game goes on from a coaching standpoint. Let's see if we can get away with it. That's the hell. I obviously being an advantage in.
Thing I think you all can help us as a group clock over here, and all I have are college books, because those are the ones I have access to. I understand that we have a huddle count. I know it's, I believe it's used in football fairly effectively. I know our football officials that do basketball love it, because the next day or a couple days after, they can go look at the specific plays, they can watch the whole game. Obviously, it's different for basketball, but some of these schools, varsity, JV, girls, boys, 3-4 nights a week. But how can we get those games? How can we, is there time for the coaches to upload this? Because this would be the best thing you can do to help us as an association, in my opinion.
Okay, so let me have a vote. And the requirement for our basketball coaches, boys and girls, is that they have to have at least 5 games on hold. But I'm going to tell you, if they're using it, they're using it religiously. Ask them.
I don't think there's a game this year that we went into that and see 2 or 3 films that the team were playing. With the huddle out there, it's real simple. We just communicate.
You ask them.
And they ask them.
So, Dave, what we need to do now is if we want to stay getting you as a good chance to call the schools there. We just need as a group, we need to communicate that better. We can get our mission on that. People watch it.
I will say this. I won't say that 100% of the schools are filming 100% of the game. But there's a, you shouldn't have to draw clips from the college.
And wait, that's something we need to prove about. They're going to do it if we get on it. And that's what you're tasked with.
I can tell you, $72,000 is what I spent for huddle.
Are you going to continue to spend that? Are you going to continue to spend it on this year? Because that's not the only one that I
know. This is the last year we're paying for.
That's what I heard about.
Yeah. So we got to get involved in this year. We're going to excuse Coach Price. He's doing the Boston boys. So this is going to play the middle school championship game this week. So congratulations.
It moved on me.